Hey out there, I'm Justin Finch, and it's Monday, September 27th. Today we'll introduce you to Gatorade's Athletes of the Year and Monday's Mean Play of the Week. Channel 1 News starts right now. Just being closer to you is my sweetest escape. It's all I need. Let's get the week rolling with a look at your Monday headlines, and Evan has our first story.
Well, a deal expired last night at midnight that could put peace between Israelis and Palestinians in major jeopardy. The deal was about this area of land between Israel and Jordan called the West Bank, which includes Bethlehem and parts of Jerusalem. It's land that the Palestinians want to use to create their own state. But Israelis have been moving into the area and building settlements until 10 months ago, when the Israeli Prime Minister agreed to freeze some construction of the settlements as a compromise so that the two sides could meet to discuss a peace deal. Israeli settlers were waiting as the clock counted down to the midnight expiration deadline. Now, the Palestinians are threatening to leave those peace talks that have been going on for the last month. Meanwhile, Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas told the United Nations General Assembly on Saturday that Israel must choose between peace and the continuation of those settlements.
All right, Evan, now AD, you're tracking some changes at the White House, right?
Right. It's almost 2 years into President Obama's term, and some of his top officials are leaving, and others are expected to follow suit. First, senior advisor David Axelrod has announced he'll be heading home to Chicago by spring to work on the president's re-election plans. And there's been a lot of talk about Chief of Staff Rahm Emanuel, who may leave as soon as next month to run for mayor of Chicago.
2 years, people start to leave. They burn themselves out, they work very hard, and they have jobs that they can't refuse on the outside.
National Economic Council head Larry Summers is going back to Harvard, and other members of the economic team are already gone. And Press Secretary Robert Gibbs is also likely to leave his job to move up to an advisor position. It sounds like a lot of changes, but actually it's happened before. Former President Bill Clinton changed chiefs of staff 4 times.
And check this out, the world record for the biggest dodgeball game ever has been set in Southern California. More than 1,700 people at the University of California, Irvine showed up to play. They faced off in teams of two, throwing around different colored dodgeballs and beating out the previous record set by students at the University of Alberta in Canada. And the student at the center of it all said he came up with the idea for the event while hanging out in his dorm room.
All right, Ali, we've got headlines all knocked out. Now it's time for our latest play of the week. It's a football play all the way from Oregon.
The game's between Grants Pass and Sheldon High Schools. Sheldon's quarterback takes the snap and throws a bullet to receiver Dante Prevost. Prevost gets wrapped up by a defender, breaks free, and runs into the end zone. Sheldon High won the game 55-7.
That was great, but think you've got a better play? Well, show us what you've got. Go over to Play of the Week at channel1.com and upload your best plays. And when we come back, find out why families across the country cleaned out their medicine cabinets. This is our night. It's the fastest growing drug problem in the U.S., abuse of prescription drugs, drugs that are found unused in medicine cabinets. And that's why the Drug Enforcement Administration has put together a campaign to get the drugs out of the cabinet and out of reach. Jessica Kumari has a story.
This is exactly what the DEA was hoping for. In churches, community centers, and fire stations across the country, hundreds cleaned out their medicine cabinets and got rid of old medications. It was part of a nationwide take-back program meant to save lives.
One day he joked that his autograph would be worth something.
Bernie Strain is talking about his son, Timothy. Timothy was recovering from a burn wound last year. To help with the pain, a friend offered some prescription pills left over in a medicine cabinet. They turned out to be methadone, a heavy-duty painkiller. 18-year-old Timothy took the pills and died that night. Timothy was a one-time user, but experts say more and more teens are abusing prescription drugs.
Most of those pharmaceutical drugs originate in our medicine cabinets in our home.
In fact, every day, 2,500 teens start abusing medicines found at home. Drugs from a medicine cabinet may seem safer than street drugs like cocaine or heroin, but experts say that's not the case. Nationwide, there were 13,800 accidental overdose deaths from prescription painkillers in 2006. And at least 7 million people are addicted to prescription drugs.
Does that go too?
The DEA's take-back program lasted only one day. But experts say if you missed it, there are proper ways to dispose of unused meds. they recommend following the disposal instructions on the medicine's label.
If there aren't any instructions on the label, you can put the drugs in a plastic bag that seals and then throw it away. This will prevent the drugs from leaking out in the garbage. Experts also suggest putting in something undesirable like salt, coffee, even dirt, because this will make the drugs less appealing to pets and those who want to abuse the drugs.
Timothy's father hopes the increased awareness about the dangers of prescription drugs will help prevent deaths like that of his son.
It was like Christmas morning when I heard that they were going to do this.
Jessica Kumari, Channel One News.
Drug enforcement officials say they're planning another National Take Back Day soon. But if you or someone you know is having trouble with prescription drugs, you can find all the resources you need to get help over at channel1.com. Coming up next, two sports names you'll want to keep your eye on. This is our night. Come look in your eyes. We can go all the way. You're losing my mind.
The music you're hearing in today's show is by Runner Runner. Check out channel1.com for artist info and your chance to win some great prizes. Need you here, but you're out
there on your own. Next up, it's an honor only given to the best of the best of America's top young men and women in sports. Here's Stephen Fabian with more on Gatorade's Athletes of the Year.
It's an award won by teenage athletes every year, and the list of past winners reads like a Hall of Fame roll call. Peyton Manning, LeBron James and Kobe Bryant, A-Rod and Joe Mauer. But next on the list...
And the winner of the 2010 Male Gatorade Athlete of the Year goes to...
And the winner is...
Get this thing open here.
Shanae Ogumike.
Brandon Knight.
Teenagers Brandon Knight and Shanae Ogumike, the latest recipients of Gatorade's Athlete of the Year award. It's been honoring high schoolers around the country for skills in their sport and in the classroom.
Oh my gosh. I'm speechless right now, completely.
To get here, all Shanae Ogumike did was lead her team to the Texas State title, while averaging 22 points and 13 rebounds a game, en route to becoming ESPNU's number one recruit in the country. And she's also a slam dunk in the classroom. She was ranked number 3 in her class, and she served as the student body president. Soon, she'll team up with her sister, Naka, an Athlete of the Year finalist herself in 2008, on the court at Stanford University in the fall.
The potential that this award brings for a player, an athlete, and a person is just unprecedented to me right now. So I'm going to work hard and see how far it will take me, and so far it hasn't taken people astray, so I'm really excited.
One of those former winners just happens to be one of Janae's childhood heroes and the person she accepted her award from, ladies hoops legend Lisa Leslie.
It's just a very special experience for me, and then to win the award and look at her, read my name up and look at me and really proud of me in a way, I just felt very special and honored.
For the boys, Fort Lauderdale, Florida native Brandon Knight also held it down on the hardwood all season long for his Pinecrest High School Panthers to grab the Athlete of the Year honors. Averaging more than 30 points a game, the 6'3" Knight led his team to the Class 3A state finals. Up next, he'll take his 4.3 GPA to basketball powerhouse, the University of Kentucky, with dreams of even more.
A dream the rest of my life? I don't know. For sure, to have a long career in the NBA, hopefully, God willing. And to be able to just to choose after that, you know, that's my main goal right now, is to be able to have a chance to play for a while at that level with great competition.
Now with two more names added to the all-star cast of former winners, the world is watching just what Shanae and Brandon will be up to next.
It's a little bit of pressure, but I think it's also motivation, just to know that they were in my shoes and one day I want to be in their shoes. So really, I think hard work and just staying focused, and you know, one day I'll be able to do what they're doing right now.
Stephen Fabian, Channel One News.
That's a pretty awesome award, and can't wait to see where those two end up. But that's our time for the day. I'm Justin Finch, and we'll see you back here tomorrow.
Produced in partnership with CBS News.